It's been a couple of weeks since I last published a video in a series about creating time-lapse videos on Prusa 3D printers. Therefore, we will continue this series with today's video. Today we are going to take a look at how to control the camera using the Kalo shutter release and the Prusa GPO hackerboard. Before we start, I would like to say a few words. Everything you will see in this video, I bought myself with my own money. Nobody has an influence on the content on the video and nobody pays me for it. If you want to support my work, you can do so by subscribing here on YouTube, on my social media and by sharing my videos. In this video, we will work with a product that is plugged into the printer motherboard and the camera. Improper handling can damage not only this product, but also the 3D printer or camera. Everything you do is at your own risk. As I said in the intro, in today's video we are going to look at how to control the camera using the cable shutter release and the Prusa GPO hackerboard. Cable shutter release support can be identified on most cameras by the symbols on the camera body or from the manufacturer's manual. Perhaps the only disadvantage of a cable trigger is that you need to have a cable long enough to not be visible in the camera. Otherwise, I can't think of anything else. I have been thinking for a long time how the topic of cable triggers should be handled. On the dogdiy.net site, you can find a sample of different cable triggers connectors and their wiring. You can find the link in the description below the video. On this page you can find a sample of different cable triggers for almost every available connector. The more observant of you will notice that a common ground, focus contact and trigger contact can be seen on almost all of the wiring diagrams. This makes our job incredibly easier. The Prusa GPO hackerboard has a total of 4 pins in the open drain section. The pins in the open drain section work by making a connection between the common ground and the selected pin when a signal is received. This allows us to use them to directly control these cable trigger connections, as these connections work on the same principle. In addition, we are not in danger of damaging the connected camera, as we are only connecting the pins to a common ground. No voltage flows to the connected device on the pins in the open drain section. For a lot of cameras, you need to follow the same procedure as for the physical shutter button on the camera body. So, you need to connect the common ground to the focus contact first and then the common ground to the shutter contact. However, not all cameras need this. For example, with the Panasonic GH4 and GH5, I have tested that it is sufficient to trigger only the shutter release. I tested this myself when I tried to build a cable shutter release for the Panasonic GH5 for this video from components I had on hand at home according to the diagram on dogdiy.net. As you can see, the cable trigger worked and nothing burned up in flames. Creating a custom cable release is not easy for all cameras due to the variety of connectors used. If you already own a cable shutter release, you can try to modify it. The inside of a simple push-button cable release should not be complicated. It should be a two-position switch connected directly to the wires leading to the camera. For such a simple cable release, just connect the common ground contact to the common ground pin of the Prusa GPO hackerboard. I recommend connecting the focus contact to pin 1 and the trigger contact to pin 0 on the Prusa GPO hackerboard. The finished solution may look like this. The G-code configuration in Prusa Slicer will be shown later. It is clear to me that not everyone will dare to create their own cable trigger or modify an existing one. That's why I decided to explore the road of ready-made solutions. I have tried several different products. In the end, I decided to go with the push-button triggers from Kiwi Photos as the clear winner. This company offers standardized solution for different types of cable triggers. So you need to find a kit that will include the connector that is suitable for your camera. The company is available on both AliExpress and Amazon. In the product descriptions on both of the mentioned sites, you can find a list of supported cameras. For my Sony ZV-1, I bought this kit which works with Sony cameras with a multi-connector. The package consists of a manual shutter release with a 2.5mm jack connector, just like the Prusa GPO hackerboard has. There is also a 1.3 meter extension cable with jack 2.5 millimeter connectors. And lastly, there is an adapter from R-Camera shutter release connector to jack 2.5 mm with a length of 70 cm. The advantage of this solution is that we actually get everything we need in one package. We get the necessary adapter that can be directly plugged into the Prusa GPO hackerboard and controlled via G-code. Thanks to the extension cable, we get a total of 2 meters long cable to control the trigger. And then there is the hand trigger itself, which you can take a picture with. If you don't want to buy the whole set, you can buy just the adapter. You can buy these adapters from JJC, Audelon or Neaver, for example. Of course, there are more manufacturers, but for example, JJC supplies them directly to Kiwi Photos. You can find the JJC company on Amazon and AliExpress. All the links to the mentioned adapters and cable triggers can be found in the video description. I purchased adapters from JJC for my Canon R5C camera and for the Panasonic GH5 camera. Because these cables work identically to the previous cables, you just need to swap the cameras along with the adapter. All wiring to the Prusa GPO hackerboard and slicer setup remains unchanged. Which reminds me, we could look at the slicer setup. Most of the settings have been already explained in previous videos. I would recommend taking a look at them. The most important is the configuration of the actual steps to set up the Prusa GPO hackerboard pins. Cable adapters from JJC, but also from all the manufacturers, work in such a way that their focus contact is in the position that corresponds to pin 1 and the trigger contact is in the position that corresponds to pin 0. So in our G-code, we need to set these pins as output. This is done before locking the nozzle to the tower parking position, which prevents the filament from leaking out of the nozzle. We then wait 500 milliseconds for the printer movements to settle. Then switch pin 1 to the active position to give the camera a signal to focus. Next, switch pin 0 to the active position to give the camera a signal to take a picture. Then wait 300 milliseconds for the camera to register the signal to take the picture. After taking the picture, we deactivate pin 0 and then pin 1. This will simulate the release of the camera shutter. Finally, wait 500 milliseconds for the image to be captured and then the printer can continue printing. If you have done everything correctly, just set up the camera as shown in the previous videos and you can start capturing the printing process. You can use DaVinci Resolve to convert the captured photos to a video, as we also demonstrated in one of the previous videos. If your camera does not support cable shutter release control, wait for the next video in this series. I will demonstrate how cameras can be controlled using wireless controllers and the Prusa GPO hackerboard.